Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I need to do a segue from where I have just come to where we were about to go. Because, in fact, I was on the other side of Doheny Library just an hour ago with a group that were discussing the Rwanda genocide, the consequences of, and the issues of memory relating to how we deal with that genocide in the aftermath. And two things that came up that relate very closely to what we're about to discuss. You see, for the people on that panel who are survivors of the genocide, propaganda and its consequences have very real meaning for their lives. Because they were the people that sat and listened to the radio. They were the folks that, as children saw the propaganda that was being produced, that resulted in the deaths of their parents and their siblings and their wider family. What we're about to talk about this evening has very real consequences for lives. And the other thing that emerged from that, which relates very closely to what we're about to discuss this evening, is this. They were here at USC, and some of you may have seen the Visions and Voices event last night, to talk about how do you express within a memorial culture the way in which you can change the way in which people think and behave and believe. And I just heard something very powerful I'd like to share with you. A woman who's 26 years old, not long graduated school, who was 8 when she saw her family being killed. And she explains that her grandmother, who is a Tutsi, holds a great deal of hatred towards those that killed her family. And her mother, who was not in Rwanda at the time, but has subsequently gone back, has adopted that sense of hatred that her grandmother feels because her family was murdered. And she said, "It's my grandmother and it's my mother, and I do not agree with either of them. And it's my responsibility to break the cycle of hatred." The segue to this, just coming from that room to this, is very real, because we're here with our colleagues from the US Holocaust Museum, who have been exemplifying through that wonderful exhibit at the US Holocaust Museum, State of Deception, precisely the power of propaganda and how it turned a nation that voted in a democratic election and then became killers and committed the genocide of the century. It was only words after all, and somehow or other there was not the power of the ability to discern what those words could ultimately do. And those words turned to actions, and those actions created genocide, and the consequences of that genocide are still here, which is why the US Holocaust Museum does the work it does in convening us here, for Michael and for our team from Washington, D.C. Thank you for being here, and thank you for convening us around this very important topic. My name is Stephen Smith. I'm the Executive Director of the USC Shoah Foundation across the quad here at Levy Library. We typed into the archive today the word propaganda. Just kind of want to know, in relation to what we're talking about, what kind of content might we expect to find there? 3,238 testimonies of survivors of the genocide of the Jews in Europe who are talking about the issue of propaganda and the effect on their lives. That is an indisputable body of evidence. And actually, body of evidence we don't know enough about. So my question as a director of that institute tonight is, how could our panel help stimulate the work we do to understand what those people have to say about this particular issue? That's why I'm particularly pleased also in welcoming you this evening to thank our colleagues at the Jesse Unruh Institute for convening us, because you're bringing to our attention something extremely important on this campus, because the president of USC talks about the fact that when we leave this campus, we want to go out and be world citizens, global world citizens. The question is, what does that mean? We live in a global society in which information moves very quickly, and we are all the owners of that information. The question is, what do we do with that? How do we use that empowerment we have in a way that can be effective for goodness in the world rather than many of the evils that we see? We're not going to solve that this evening, but we are going to discuss some of those issues. And finally, to our other partners this evening, the Casden Institute here, Bruce Zuckerman and your colleagues, always bring to great programming to USC. I want to thank you for doing that, because actually when we work on these issues, it's not about what one institute or one academician or one person that's studied media and propaganda has to bring. It's how we digest that and make it make sense in our world. And our world here right now is USC. There's 35,000 of us sitting on this campus right now. We have an impact on the world. We're all tweeting and Facebooking and all the rest of it. I can't tell you what to do with that. But good news is we've got a great panel of people that can, and it's a great pleasure to be here to listen to you all. Thank you.
Good evening, and thank you all for coming tonight. My name is Michael Sarid, and I am the West Coast Regional Director for the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. I'm very honored to welcome you to tonight's program, Mind Over Media, Politics, Propaganda, and the Digital Age, co-presented with the USC Casden Institute for the Study of the Jewish Role in American Life, the USC Jesse M. Unruh Institute of Politics, and of course the USC Shoah Foundation, to all of whom we are so very grateful. On the museum's behalf, I would especially like to thank Stephen Smith, who we've just heard from. Stephen, you and your team at the Shoah Institute have been incredible partners to the museum in every way, in so many ways, and since the very beginning of both of our institutions, as we work together to preserve memory, to advance scholarship, and to educate the public. I would also like to especially thank Dan Schnur, who joined us a few months ago as part of a similar panel discussion at the Paley Center for Media, and whose enthusiasm for this topic has led him to bring this discussion here to USC. Finally, I'd like to thank Bruce Zuckerman of the Casden Institute for your institute does such incredible quality programming, and we're so proud to be part of that series that you have here at USC this evening. And to everyone at USC, we want to thank you for being such gracious hosts and for making me and my museum colleagues feel so incredibly welcome. I'm going to say a few words about the museum and put this program in a little bit of context for you. But before I do that, I am delighted to introduce to you tonight's speakers. Our co-moderators of tonight's panel are Dan Schnur, director of USC's Jesse Unruh Institute of Politics, and Daniel Rothberg, the news editor of the Daily Trojan. Our panelists are Eli Attie, television producer and screenwriter on shows including The West Wing and former speechwriter for Vice President Al Gore, Dr. Stephen Luckert, senior curator at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum and responsible for both our permanent exhibition as well as our State of Deception exhibit on the topic of Nazi propaganda, Dr. Nancy Snow, professor of communications at Cal State Fullerton and adjunct professor at the USC Annenberg School for Communications and Journalism, and Tom Waldman, director of media and communications at the Los Angeles Unified School District. A warm welcome to each of you, and thank you so much for your participation tonight. So, the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum is our nation's living memorial to the millions who were murdered in the Holocaust. Standing on the National Mall in the shadow of the Washington Monument, the museum has educated and inspired more than 30 million visitors since we opened our doors nearly 20 years ago. But the museum is much more than a building in Washington. We train school teachers in all 50 states on how to make Holocaust history meaningful and relevant to today's young people. We teach the lessons of the Holocaust to our nation's judges, military, and law enforcement professionals to make them better able to safeguard our fragile democracy. We bring together policymakers, diplomats, and even heads of state in an effort to understand contemporary genocide and prevent its recurrence. And finally, as you'll hear more about tonight, the museum has a tremendously active online presence, a website, ushmm.org, which has been translated into 19 different languages. It is accessed by more than 30 million people a year, and it has become an integral part of our mission to confront hate, prevent genocide, and promote human dignity. Tonight's program is an outgrowth of the museum's groundbreaking special exhibition entitled State of Deception, The Power of Nazi Propaganda, which for several years has been on view both at the museum as well as online. The good news is that we will be taking State of Deception on a national tour over the next 2 years. We don't yet have a booking here in LA, but please stay tuned. We're working on it. Hopefully you'll all have the opportunity to view that exhibition in person. But in the meantime, I encourage each of you to please visit our website and check out our digital version of this extraordinary exhibition. What State of Deception shows us is that the Holocaust did not begin with mass murder. It began with ideas, it began with information, and it began with a political party using the most sophisticated information technology available in their day to disseminate a message of hate, intolerance, and inhumanity. Sadly, this phenomenon of propaganda as a tool of hate did not end in 1945, and today there are literally thousands of hate sites out there on the World Wide Web which get millions of hits a day from people all over the world. And this alarming phenomenon is growing. We have to ask ourselves the question, how prepared are we as a society to handle the massive amount of unmediated information bombarding us daily? How vulnerable are we to the use of digital media by hate groups to poison our attitudes and dull our sensitivities? And most importantly, what can we do to empower and inoculate ourselves from this kind of influence? To protect the next generation of information consumers, and to ensure that there's meaning behind the phrase, never again. What I'd like to do next is to show all of you a brief museum video about this very topic. It shows what the museum is in fact doing to counter all the hate and intolerance that's out there in our information-saturated culture. We hope that the museum's activities in this arena, along with tonight's discussion, will inspire each of you to take action, to get involved, to confront hate and indifference when you encounter them, digitally or otherwise, in your own lives. Just a couple of quick announcements before we begin our program. On Monday, October 29th, please join us for another fascinating panel discussion right here at USC, entitled Beyond Numbers, Creating a Personal History of the Holocaust, about the museum's recently published Encyclopedia of Camps and Ghettos, and featuring scholars both from the museum as well as the USC Shoah Foundation. There's information about that event on the flyers that are available at the information table. And finally, I'm truly delighted to share the news with you that the coming year marks the museum's 20th anniversary. And to celebrate that occasion, we are going to be holding a very special event here in LA next February at the Skirball Museum. The date is February 17th. I hope you will all mark your calendars. The day will feature lectures, panel discussions, films, opportunities for family research, as well as a special tribute to the Holocaust survivors, liberators, and rescuers who reside here in the Los Angeles area. This will be an all-day event that we're offering free of charge to the entire community. And we'd love for you to be part of it. So to make sure that you receive our invitation and learn about other special events in the future, I'm going to ask each of you to please fill out one of our e-community cards tonight. And if you can drop it off at the front table as you leave, that way you'll be sure to be informed of everything that we do. So again, thank you very much. And now on to our video.
Holocaust did not have to happen. It could have been avoided. The Holocaust did not start with murder. The Holocaust started with propaganda.
We live in a world where hate is more dangerous than ever. This is one of thousands of hate sites on the internet. They're in many different languages. And what's really frightening is that it's available in all different ways, YouTube and other forms of social media.
The implications of this for children and teenagers is that now with one or two or three clicks, it's possible to find yourself participating in a set of ideas, a set of messages that are really and truly destructive and inhumane.
Young people are our most important audience.
The next question is, what is propaganda?
And as technology changes, we are going to have to change. Because we have to be where the world is if we are to be faithful to our mission.
What the Holocaust Museum is doing with the use of cell phones as an interactive tool is some of the most exciting work that we're seeing today.
This propaganda initiative enables them to actually have an interactive experience through texting with a Holocaust survivor about the meaning of propaganda.
What emotions did the Nazis hope these images would evoke among Germans?
And why they should be thinking about what that means for their world.
Hate is not something that children are born with. Hate is a learned behavior.
What children and young people need to acquire is a set of critical thinking skills, because by learning to recognize propaganda, we take the first step in learning to resist it. Through digital media, we don't need to be at the museum to have that rich engagement experience.
The museum has and will continue to look at its mission as beyond the four walls. It's no longer about physical place, it's about virtual connection.
We have this one in Farsi.
We translate our website to reach populations that we think are most critical for our message, especially in today's world where denial is so prevalent. The goal of this project is more important than ever.
So this could be an opportunity. We could put this video on YouTube in languages other than English.
The museum has really created a space, a virtual space. I think that's a model for what institutions are going to be in this new interconnected world.
Welcome to Voices on Anti-Semitism, a free podcast series of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum.
I chose this podcast because it's very important for me as a teacher to have tools to work with my students so that they can have a shield against all the propagandas outside the school. We have to stop it. And to stop it, the best thing to do is to teach.
The museum's investment in digital media education, bringing the story of the Holocaust and the story of propaganda to the world, has enormous possibilities for thinking about the future of education overall.
Our job is really to confront indifference and to reach people everywhere who can act differently in the future than we know people have acted in the past.
Each one of us really has the responsibility of making sure that what you do counts.
Thank you. Let me join my voice to those of Dr. Smith and Michaels to thank you all for coming tonight. My name is Dan Schnur, and I'm the director of the Just Unruh Institute of Politics here at USC. And I can't tell you how thrilled we are in partnership with the Shoah Foundation and our friends at the Casden Institute to be able to work with the folks at the U.S. Holocaust Museum to bring you tonight's program. As Michael mentioned, this past spring, I participated in a program on this topic at the Paley Museum in Beverly Hills. And I was so struck by the work that had been done at the museum, so struck by the exhibit, and so much enjoyed the conversation that after the program concluded, I said in what I thought was sort of a giveaway to Michael, I said, you know, if the opportunity ever existed, we'd love to host a program like this at USC. And by the time I woke up the next morning, I had emails from no fewer than three members of his staff at the Holocaust Museum, which I interpreted as some level of interest. And we were very flattered and very grateful and very thrilled to have the opportunity to work again with Michael and with his colleagues, with Dana Sherman and with Chris Brown, in putting this program together. And as soon as we began the conversation, what I realized almost immediately is to bring a program of this import to the USC campus, it was something that is capable, as our Institute of Politics is, at a lot of things. This is something that was much bigger in scope. that our Institute of Politics should try to take on its own, even in cooperation with the people at the Holocaust Museum. And so I reached out immediately to Bruce Zuckerman and to Lisa Ansel at the Casden Institute, and to Dr. Smith and to Dan Leshen at the Shoah Foundation. And we are extremely, extremely grateful to them, not only for joining us and helping us put this program together, but helping to give it the breadth and the depth of the conversation of this import deserves. At the Institute of Politics, at the Jess Unruh Institute of Politics, we put on programming primarily dealing with contemporary politics. And over the course of the semester, we'll do between 20 and 25 panels and lunches and seminars and conferences dealing with various aspects of politics, government, public policy, particularly in the arena of messaging and communications. And what I found when I had the privilege of participating in the event with the folks from the museum this spring is how easy it is when we talk about contemporary politics, when we talk about presidential election in present-day America, how easy it is to trivialize the power of messaging and the power of communications. How's Romney going to defend that video? How's Obama going to talk about health care? And we spend so much time talking about this and thinking about this and watching the nice folks at MSNBC and Fox putting aside their partisan differences to talk these things through rationally, that it becomes really easy to forget the real power of messaging and communications when in the hands of an extremely talented communicator, for good or for bad. And so that's why I think that tonight's conversation is so important. And as the campaign progresses, we hope that many of you will join us for our events at the Unruh Institute for a conversation of this election as it progresses. But I think I speak for all of my colleagues at the Institute that while we are certainly interested and engaged and at times fascinated by the conversation that takes place on the campaign trail, a discussion like tonight, is much greater, much broader, and much deeper, and of much more import. So thank you all for being here with us. Michael introduced our panelists, and so I'm going to get right to it with one quick exception. Michael, in addition to introducing our panelists, introduced my co-moderator, and Daniel Rothberg is the news editor of the Daily Trojan. And I will tell you just one other thing about the Jess Unruh Institute of Politics. Like I said, we put on a couple of dozen events a semester, and we have one rule and one rule only for our events. We will not put on a program of any size, of any scope, unless it includes students, not just as members of the audience, but as participants and panelists. Because we want USC students to understand that politics, whether in 2012 or in 1932, is not the province of old white guys in suits. But there's room for young guys in suits, too. That, in fact, we want to make sure that our students understand at age 18, 19, 20, 21, that their thoughts, their opinions, their input is just as valid and just as important. And for those of you students who are attending one of our events for the first time, we hope you'll come back not just as audience members, but as participants. Tonight's program is being presented, of course, in conjunction not only with the museum, but with their groundbreaking exhibition, State of Deception, The Power of Nazi Propaganda. And for those of you who have not seen it in Washington or online, I can't tell you how strongly I urge you to take advantage of this tremendous educational opportunity. And as I mentioned a moment ago, even in this highly contentious election year, the American public finds itself assaulted with partisan messaging of a different type. And living in a society like this one, I think tonight's conversation can be interesting to us, not just from a historical perspective, but to help us decide how we in the 21st century process information we receive, and accordingly how we know what to believe, how to separate fact from fiction, how to separate information from opinion, how to separate necessary knowledge from propaganda.
The Pew Research Center for the People and the Press has been tracking views of press performance since 1985, and the overall ratings remain quite negative. Just a quick switch. Fully 66% say stories are often inaccurate, and 77% think that the news organizations tend to favor one side. and 80% say news organizations are often influenced by powerful people and organizations. But Americans have a very different view of the news sources they rely on than they do of the news media generally. When asked to rate the accuracy of stories from the sources where they get most of the news, the percentage saying these outlets get the facts straight from more than doubles. Fully 62% say their main news source gets the facts straight, while just 30% say stories are often inaccurate.
The research suggests that while the number of national news sources are increasing, we tend to rely on a diminishing number of sources for accuracy and independence and information. Nick Kristof, the fine New York Times columnist, refers to this phenomenon as the me network. That technology allows us to construct an information environment that reinforces what we already believe. And if you think about this, this is totally predictable human nature. I'm a smart, informed person, and I want to read and listen to and talk to the smartest, most informed people in the world. Who are the smartest, most informed people in the world? The people who agree with me. And whether I find them on Fox or MSNBC or somewhere else, I know that those most intelligent voices are going to tell me what I already know to be true. Do we just tune into a voice that's most like our own for validation of our already biased points of view? And if so, what does that mean for the political process? Does new technology and citizen journalism help to resolve the issue of accuracy? Or contribute to the debate over what truly is accurate? But let's take a step back. We'll return to the present day in a little while and talk about propaganda in our modern day society. But let's, as Michael and Dr. Smith alluded to, let's go back several decades. And I'm going to turn to Dr. Luckert in just a second. But before I do, in just a moment, I want to show you an image. I'm showing you an image. Propaganda. Adolf Hitler declared in 1924 in his book, Mein Kampf, My Struggle, is, quote, a truly terrible weapon in the hands of an expert, unquote. During the subsequent two decades, Nazi leaders showed the world bold new ways to use this tool. So, Steve, I'm going to begin this conversation, finally, with you. Steve, can you talk a little bit about how the Nazis rose to power in one of the most highly educated nations in the world and in a democracy with a free press? And in researching this topic, talk a little bit about how the Nazis used propaganda. What was the most unique and interesting you found in your research of how this was accomplished?
Well, Dan, you raise a great question and one that we give a lot of thought to. When we were doing the research, we began research on the exhibition about 7 years ago. One of the astounding things that we discovered was how important propaganda played in Nazi strategy in a democracy, where they had to compete against 30 other political parties, and how they used propaganda to transform themselves from a minor extremist party into the largest political party represented in the German parliament in just a few short years. For much of that German democracy, that period between the end of 1918 and 1933, the Nazis were a joke. But then I'll give you an example. In 1928, Nazis had 12 seats in the German parliament. 2.6% of the seats there. They were nothing. The next national election in 1930, they had 107 seats. Then the next national election after that, 230 seats. They went from political obscurity to political prominence in just a couple of years. It happened during the Great Depression when there was a fertile ground, a fertile environment for those ideas. But they were able to sell their message to people that never would have thought about voting for them just a couple of years before. And they did that using very sophisticated propaganda, that they honed those skills in a democracy. They engaged in what we would call today niche marketing, tailoring their messages to particular groups, to women, to farmers, to workers, to students, to Catholics, to even bank employees. that they were very sophisticated about that. They also were interested in technology and understood the importance of it. They produced their own records, which they sold and rented. They produced their own films beginning in the 1920s and went from silent films to sound films. They were selling them, branding themselves as a new movement that represented all Germans, regardless of what class you belong to, what religion you belong to, what region you came from. They said, we're open to all Germans. Of course, they meant all racially pure Germans. But they were portrayed themselves as one big tent, allowing everybody in there. And they used seductive images, slogans, talking about how they were going to create jobs. They said, well, we'll give you bread and work. We'll give you freedom. All very appealing things. But they are rather amorphous. But they were appealing to people when you had millions of people unemployed. And they were so, and they created their own logo. This was an extremely talented and sophisticated group of people that tried to sell their message for this extremist party. And I think their success showed how skillfully they employed this weapon.
See, thank you. We're going to stick with you for just another minute. But can we show the next? Can we show the next slide, Dana? Steve. Why is this poster effective?
Well, this is a very interesting poster for a variety of reasons. It's a very simple poster. It's very simple graphically. It's just got one word and a face. But when you go beyond that, one of the things that's interesting about that is the ways in which the Nazis created this cult of personality around Adolf Hitler. The ways in which he crafted an image of himself as a political leader, as a public persona. If you look at it, he's portrayed as the way movie stars were portrayed in the 1920s and 30s. It has that kind of pointing to the star quality. It also has what we would say is kind of a direct appeal. That is, he's looking directly into the voters' eyes. Like Uncle Sam wants you. That is, he's asking you to do something, and what is that? Vote for Adolf Hitler. This is when he ran for president in 1932. Didn't win, but he got 13, 14 million votes. And he had only become a German citizen just weeks before. And the last thing that I want to say about this poster, and this says something about the sophistication of the Nazi Party, is that they held this poster up till the final weeks of that campaign. Because they argued the other political candidates for president were going to use brightly colored posters. They said, if you put this one up, this is the one that's going to get noticed. And it was true. You see, there's film footage of this on kiosks. All next to it are anti-Hitler, anti-Nazi posters. But it's this one that catches your eye. And I think that says something about how, even before they came into power, how sophisticated they were in honing their talents as propagandists, in selling their messages, selling this image of Adolf Hitler to the German people. And so I think that there are a lot of lessons and warnings that can be drawn from this.
We're going to fast forward a couple of decades in just a moment. But before we do, I just want to offer one thought. When Stephen was talking about how compelling this was and what a powerful visage this was, many of us, myself included, giggled a little bit because you look at that and say, how persuasive can that be? How compelling can that be? And of course, what's worth remembering is we have several decades of perspective here. We know who that is. We know what he did. But absent all that knowledge, that sort of stark, direct, no-frills messaging is something that can really carry a much greater wallop. And just because we have the historical perspective that the German people of the 1930s doesn't, I don't think should detract at all from what Stephen is telling us. Daniel?
All right. Skipping ahead now to our own country, during the 1964 presidential campaign, a TV ad called the Daisy Commercial ran only once, yet created such a controversy that it is still discussed today.
the stakes to make a world in which all of God's children can live are to go into the dark. We must either love each other or we must die.
Vote for President Johnson on November 3rd. Mm-hmm. The stakes are too high for you to stay home.
For those of you who follow contemporary politics closely, you may be familiar with the term a show-me ad. And that's an advertisement that's particularly provocative and particularly controversial that a campaign will run just once or twice, or not run at all, just put on their website in order to engender a conversation through the news media. Well, that ad ran once. And here we are half a century later almost, and we are still talking about it. The ultimate show-me ad, Tom Waldman. Tom, what was so groundbreaking about this commercial?
Johnson's opponent was Barry Goldwater, who was, at that point in American history, the angriest and probably most frightening conservative, although a very charming man in another way, to the voters. Goldwater had, going sort of in the terminology of politics, Goldwater didn't define himself very well. He did make statements about lobbing nuclear bombs into the men's room of the Kremlin, off the cuff sort of, but nevertheless, the kinds of things that could be easily seized upon by his opponent. But it's interesting because Dan's right, the ad ran once, and if I may sort of vary my answer a little bit, one of the people who I think paid very close attention to that ad and the reaction to it was a guy who was in the Goldwater campaign and was a rising star at the end of the Goldwater campaign named Ronald Reagan. And a couple years later, Reagan ran for governor of California and then ran for president in 1980, and he always said that Barry Goldwater's message was much too harsh and Barry Goldwater was too harsh, and it was easy to exploit what Goldwater presented with an ad like that. Think about Ronald Reagan in an ad like that, and it wouldn't have been as effective. So the Johnson people knew their opponent. They knew that their opponent scared a lot of people in this country with his irresponsible statements about nuclear war and the Cold War in the midst of the Cold War, and that ad was a consequence of that.
Thank you, Tom. I'm going to turn to Eli now, and then we'll come to Nancy in just a moment. Eli, you are a talented propagandist in only the best sense of the word.
Thank you very much.
A speechwriter for Vice President of the United States, and now developing messages for public consumption through the popular culture. So I'll ask your subjective opinion on this. Watching today's campaign advertising, watching today's dramatic programming, that seems pretty ham-handed. It seems pretty over the top. But was it effective propaganda?
I actually think, and I'm sure, Dan, you know this really well from your time in politics, that when I sit around, and now, you know, I'm with TiVo, I don't watch a lot of TV commercials when I watch network television, but sometimes I do, and you'll see these kind of multi-million dollar advertising campaigns with panoramic shots of the Everglades, and it's to sell a cola or something that has no connection to anything, and they spend so much money and so much time. I know people who make them. And the best political ads, and there are a lot of slick, expensive political ads now, too, and also the ways of making them are cheaper and more accessible, but it's like that Hitler poster. Stark, raw, a single image, a single slogan. I mean, I've always joked to friends that, I mean, the political version of a cola ad is Pepsi causes cancer. Do you know what I mean? That would be the Coke ad. You know, you don't need all this kind of story and whatever. I mean, that's the analogy. I'm not saying it's, you know, a good idea or accurate, but
the views represented here do not reflect those of the...
Yeah, right. No, I mean, I'm not saying it does cause cancer. But the more you can strip it down, the more you can pare it down. So I sometimes think even the, you know, Obama and Romney ads that I've seen in the last few weeks have way too much going on and have too many data points and are speaking to too many demographics. And, you know, the thing that was so interesting about that Hitler poster to me, which I wasn't familiar with, I don't even remember if that was shown at the other panel, is that it's a little bit like, well, you know, it was a horrible time economically for Germany, the interwar period, and there was like, you know, triple digit inflation, and people were really struggling, and Hitler looked so grim, he looked so serious, he looked really tough and strong, if you didn't know, you know, about the genocide and all that stuff. And there's a great article in this week's New Yorker about the birth of modern political consulting that talks about the Eisenhower campaign for president and how he wasn't a warm, fuzzy guy, so they kind of almost tried to mold in his advertising and in his messaging, mold the times to him, that we needed a tough leader because he wasn't going to break into a big smile. I just think clarity, simplicity, and I don't see that from either presidential campaign right now.
I have a question from Nancy Snow. What are today, what are some of the risks and returns of using the ads, provocative ads, and sort of the ads that Eli was just describing?
Well, I actually wanted to mention, related to the Daisy ad, because I agree with you that the Hitler poster is very artistic. I hadn't seen that before. It's sort of reflective of the time, kind of an Art Deco element to it. And
it's kind of brilliant. I mean, just
it is quite brilliant.
But
again, you have to use your eyes in that period of how people responded to it. Tony Schwartz was the co-creator of the Daisy Girl ad, and he was with DDB Doyle, Jane Birnbach, and they were famous for creating those very simple VW ads, where they made the little VW bug a very appealing vehicle through its simplicity. The value in simplicity is that you can add whatever you want to. It becomes Tony Schwartz said that this was the first national Rorschach test. So kind of fill in the blank there. And Bill Moyers, whom we know today as sort of the moral conscience of the media, he was LBJ's press ad. He had to give the green light to LBJ doing the voiceover. The voiceover is really important at the end too. So with Barry Goldwater, he went, his slogan was, in your heart, you know he's right, to this consequence of in your guts, you know he's nuts, right? And you know, unfortunately for him, even Goldwater said, had I not known who was sort of behind all of this, I wouldn't have voted for that guy either. I mean, he was saying it was quite an effective ad. Look, today there's a great payoff to taking risk in ads. And I am a political independent, but I'm going to state right now with the election going on that I think we're all sort of sick of a lot of the political campaign ads, frankly. But we would like to see something that is clever and thought-provoking. And as I was preparing for today, I couldn't help but remember Hillary Clinton's 08 ad, the 3 a.m. phone call. Didn't we all think, answer the phone, you know, as I was watching that ad. And that was the phones ringing incessantly. And it's sort of who you're going to call. And it would be Hillary Clinton in that case. But you have to take some risk because there's so much political campaign ad clutter out there today.
Tom?
Well, it's interesting because Nancy's talking about these ads. We're not seeing these ads in California. Mm. We're not a contested state.
Right.
So in a certain sense, there's two campaigns going on in the United States right now. There's the campaign that you're seeing in Nevada and Virginia and Colorado, where these ads, the ads Eli's talking about, are. You're constantly seeing them, and you're seeing ads on top of ads, and ads responding to the previous ad. And we're not getting that in California. So there's an interesting situation going on in the country right now where these ads are focused on the so-called swing states.
Though, you know what's interesting, and this is brand new, I think, that, you know, when I was working in politics not that long ago now, 12 years ago, I guess that is a long time, in the sense that that was still a time where if you wanted to, as you know, Dan is suggesting, leverage a lot of press coverage of an ad. When the now deceased Paul Wellstone ran for the Senate for the first time, he had like $5. He had no money. So he created these very edgy, funny TV ads, and they really could only afford to run them two or three times. It wasn't because they were controversial, but they were parodies of the Michael Moore movie, Roger and Me, and they got him a lot of attention. Now with the internet, you're right that these ads are not on TV in California, and I follow politics pretty closely, but I feel like I see them all, because NPR does pieces about them, the New York Times links to them, you know, any blog, political, you know, I'm sure the average voter is not seeing a ton of them, but weirdly now, it's it's much cheaper and easier to drive a message, and you don't have to go as far, you don't have to be as edgy to get attention, because you're not basically asking Walter Cronkite to devote a minute and a half to your ad. You're just hoping it gets on the blogs and it gets on YouTube and gets some hits.
Did anybody explain, by the way, why the ad only ran once? It was because the networks ran the ad in its entirety. They really didn't have to run it again. And then Time Magazine took a freeze frame from the ad, and it ran in the magazine. And think about the era of the influence of the weekly magazines then and the three major networks. So their work was done.
Daniel Patrick Moynihan is famously reported to have said, we may each be entitled to our own set of opinions, but we are not entitled to our own set of facts. I'm actually going to ask this question to Dan. What happens when the public creates content on the internet and there's no organized system to rely on to hash out the truths?
Well, you know, to me this goes back to what we talked about in the preamble before the panelists had a chance to weigh in. We saw the changes that developed in terms of messaging between the 1930s and the 1960s. Of course, the greatest change between the 1960s and today is how much more empowered we all are, not only to select our own content and our own information, our own opinion, but of course to create it. And Eli was talking a moment ago about how an ad like the Daisy ad would have lived in perpetuity on the blogs. Well, I suspect in today's media environment, that ad would have run on MSNBC repeatedly, and the Goldwater campaign would have responded with an ad that ran on Fox News repeatedly. Back to Tom's point, no one would have seen both ads because no one was making themselves available in the entire information environment. And I don't think anywhere is this information self-selection process more important than in terms of online campaigning. The best thing, I'll call this the politics in an iPod nation. The best thing about my iPod is that it's empowering. I can listen to whatever I want to whenever I want to, and I can watch whatever I want to whenever I want to. When I tell my students what it was like looking for your favorite song on the car radio, I don't know if you remember, or rushing home from dinner to watch your favorite television program, I might as well be talking to them about the butter churn of the Model T because they have never had to do that. Now, if my internet is empowering, and allows me to hear whatever I want to and watch whatever I want to and participate in any conversation I want to whenever I want to, that empowerment far outweighs the downside. But the downside of my iPod is that it's also isolated. And once I put those white plugs in my ears, I very quickly lose any interest in what anybody else is talking about or listening to or thinking about. And if the stakes are country versus hip-hop, not that big a deal. But what if the stakes are whether or not to raise taxes? How to fix a broken system of public education, how to engage in an increasingly difficult and hostile and problematic part of the world. If one watches Fox and one watches MSNBC, if one watches likes Hannity, the other likes Huffington, if one likes O'Reilly, the other likes Olbermann, we're not just coming to different conclusions from the same set of information, but we're living in two entirely different versions of reality. And to me, what this means, and I'm fascinated to hear our panel on this, is it means a shift of responsibility from three news anchors sitting in New York and the editors of the Washington Post and the New York Times. It shifts responsibility from them as to what is and what is not credible news. It shifts the responsibility to each of us to decide for ourselves what we can believe and should believe without question and what we need to more aggressively question. Eli, I'll start with you on this one. When everyone's their own news network, how do you bring people together?
Well, you know, there's two things I would say to that. One, you just made me think of something, which is, I don't know if people in this room have heard of a guy named Mark Penn, who's a very well-known political pollster, and he worked for Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton and Al Gore and lots of people. He actually just took a job at Microsoft. But when he was doing the Clinton re-election campaign in 1996, Clinton had really heavily relied on focus groups when he ran for president the first time, which we probably all know about, just a bunch of people in a room and a moderator. It's a little bit like this panel. And he completely did away with them in just doing his polling because his theory was people will say one thing in a group, but they might vote differently then they will represent their opinions in the group. Because really, when you vote, you're just alone with your thoughts in the booth. Which I agree with you about sort of iPod Nation and how we're becoming more solitary and less engaged from our communities. But at the same time, I think even if we weren't, there's a danger that people, sometimes these choices are made, you know, by life is hard on the farm and look at the guy on the poster and you sort of sink into yourself and your community may not be saying all the right things or maybe saying all the right things and you make a different choice. I just think, you know, sometimes people are by nature solitary, you know, at a certain level. But in terms of just the media clutter, I'm a little more optimistic about it, maybe, in the sense that there's so much white noise. When you have Fox News and MSNBC and a million blogs and magazines and newspapers and TV shows on every little, you know, spot on the political map, it becomes harder, actually, for misinformation to get through. You know, talking about how you can generate inaccurate content on the internet. I mean, the major campaigns, the Romney campaign and the Obama campaign, are using quotes completely out of context, being slammed by every, you know, major news organization for doing it in ads. But there's so much stuff out there, none of that information is really moving the dial. So you reach a point where there's such oversaturation that as few big events really shape the campaigns as used to be the case 40 years ago, is what I think.
And the really insidious part of these individual information environments, of course, is that the campaigns have decided that when the Washington Post or the Los Angeles Times said the ad is a lie, they don't pull the ad.
Right.
They brag about it. And their strongest supporters say, yeah, you go get him and run that ad 100 times more. Steve, I want to pick up on something that Eli just mentioned in passing, but I think it's particularly fascinating. He talked about the separation from the individual's private deliberations and how they behave in public, whether that's in a focus group or at a rally or in the broader community. Talk a little bit about the public and peer pressures that existed in pre-World War II Nazi Germany to force people, even with some reservations, some concerns, to jump on board that bandwagon.
Well, I think the Nazis were smart enough to realize that not everybody was going to vote for them. But particularly after they came to power, Goebbels said this, that the goal was to win over those millions of people that didn't vote for them, that to convince them. And they harnessed all kinds of things to do that, radio, the press, in an effort to try to win over millions of people, to show them that the new Germany was for everybody and all that. And I think that they understood, too, something, one might say it's a kind of early type of group or crowd psychology, that people behave differently in a collective. So when you think of Hitler would write about, for instance, these mass rallies, and talk about how the individual, the individual becomes subsumed by the collective, and how the people behave differently, for instance, at night. That, you know, so the Nazis work to create an atmosphere, you know, whether that's through lights, whether that's through music, to try to create this collective, this kind of national community in this collective environment. And they played on that. And so they understood something about crowd psychology and tried to manipulate people, particularly their emotions.
Going off of that and talking about sort of this idea of bringing the collective, the lights and stuff like that, and sort of as a group and group psychology, I have a question for Tom, actually. Today, a lot of campaigns, the focus is sort of this micro-targeting and picking out people with voter research and stuff like that. Do you think there's still an emphasis on sort of strategies involving group psychology, or is it mostly just very, very focused targeting on particular voters and particular voter groups?
I think it's more targeting voter groups, and I think we seem to have the campaign tale that's being told right now is that the next 7 weeks of the campaign are going to be focused on this group called independent voters, and the debates will be geared toward that, and advertising will be geared toward them. And they, who they are, and maybe Eli knows this better than I do, who they are, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. If somebody said, take a piece of paper and a pencil and draw a picture of an independent voter, I don't know what I'd draw. And I don't know how to get to them in a kind of overall general sense. But the campaigns, I think what they will do is probably turn up the volume on their sort of fundamental message and figure that that's going to cut through to this independent voter and finally tell this independent voter, you really shouldn't be independent, you should vote for me. And I think that that's because of the polarization that Dan talked about, most people seem to have made up their mind. I don't think that means the campaign's going to be uninteresting for the next 7 weeks, but I think it's going to be geared towards that person, whoever he or she may be.
I know, Nancy, I'm going to pick out one type of swing voter, perhaps the most important type in this and most recent presidential elections. As many of you know, you've read quite a bit about the gender gap in American politics, how female voters are much more likely to vote Democratic and male voters are much more likely to vote Republican. Some of you may have also read about the so-called marriage gap in American politics. Married voters are much more likely to vote Republican. Single voters are much more likely to vote Democrat. So break that down. What does that mean? That means single female voters are the most reliable Democratic voting group, demographically speaking. That means married men are the single most reliable demographic group for Republicans. Single men actually don't vote. They read Maxim and they watch Spike TV. They really don't pay attention to these things. The most important swing group in this election are married female voters. And Nancy, talking about this both in a historical and present day context, I find this campaign fascinating. Because Mitt Romney says, if you are a married female voter, the most important thing to you is the economic security of you and your children and your family. If Barack Obama's talking to that same married voter, he says, think about abortion rights. Think about the education of your children. Think about providing health care. It's two very powerful emotional messages. And a lot of them, strikes me, are using precisely the same techniques as Stephen was talking about earlier. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, actually, I can't speak for a married woman voter.
No.
But I am a political independent. And, you know, so maybe you can draw a picture of a political independent here. Anybody else who's a political independent in the audience? So if they're really speaking to us, you nailed it on the head, though, with the use of emotion. And I was talking earlier about Ann Romney, who I thought was going to be kind of the secret weapon for Mitt Romney until I saw her interview on Rock Center, Brian Williams' show. I don't know if anybody saw it, but it was about a month ago. And it was with a female journalist asking her about the just sort of leaning in and saying kind of, how much are you worth? Something along those lines. And Ann Romney's response was to say, well, I really don't know. I'm paraphrasing. But she said that as of 2002, that their wealth was in blind trust. And I've shared this in my classes, and I've said, you know when you're really wealthy, it's when you don't know how much you have, and you have a blind trust on top of it all. So I thought that that was probably the depth of the campaign, that she was no longer really the secret weapon. In addition, she also had such an aversion to the press overall, which she also shared with the reporter on Rock Center, which was bizarre to me. That's something you share in private. So,
and Nancy, it seems to me, makes a fascinating point. And we're way behind schedule because I think we're having a fascinating conversation, so I'll apologize for that. But before we move on, I got to go back now to Steve to build on a point that Nancy alluded to. What Nancy talked about, this is a very important concept in politics. As it happened, this particular example was self-inflicted. But a successful communicator, whether a Reagan or a Clinton or a Hitler, the way a successful communicator reaches out to an audience is by building an emotional connection between himself or herself and the audience. This is what we have in common. What a negative message does, whether from the other side or occasionally self-inflicted, is it destroys that emotional connection. It says, actually, he or she's got nothing in common with you at all. And it seems to me, from the little bit of reading I've done, certainly compared to you, Steve, this was one of Hitler's most powerful tools. Not just establishing an emotional connection between himself and the German people, but creating a disconnection between the people and their leaders in the 1920s and in early 30s. Breeding some suspicion and lack of commonality to lay the groundwork for his own messaging opportunities. Is that?
Yeah, I think it's kind of interesting the way Hitler created this myth about himself in the campaigns when he was running for president and throughout the 1920s and 30s. His propagandists, they created this image of him as kind of the common man, the unknown soldier that fought in the war, the guy that was like everybody else, who wasn't born with a silver spoon in his mouth, somebody who had to work his way up. He was kind of the person that, you know, pulled himself up from his bootstraps. He's a perfect figure for a kind of democratic politics. He's somebody that essentially went into politics right after the First World War, and that he, in some ways, we're trying to make that link with the everyman, that there was something about him that was like, you know, everyone else there.
Oh my goodness, I will just say, Steve, I'm sorry to interrupt, but when you talk about saying, I wasn't born with a silver spoon, I'm just like you, I pulled myself up by the bootstraps, I'm a regular guy, I find it absolutely chilling to take that language and reapply it from the 1920s. To the 1980s right. And 1990s and 21st century in this country. I didn't mean to interrupt, but when I get chills, I can't help myself.
But, you know, Dan, just plain folks is one of the original mm-hmm. seven propaganda devices mm-hmm. that the Institute for Propaganda Analysis gave us. So it's a card that we play over and over. I mean, propaganda really, at its most simple, is the most effective.
Yeah, they say there's no such thing as an original spin. There's one last thing we want to cover, and then we do want to open it up to all of your questions. Dana, we're going to go straight to the White Rose, okay? The White Rose resistance movement, one of the few German groups that spoke out against Nazi genocidal policies, was founded by a group of university students who covertly transported and mailed mimeographed leaflets that denounced the regime. In the 1930s, the mimeograph and mail were cutting-edge technologies for widespread message dissemination. Let's imagine for a moment what the White Rose could have done had the internet and social media been available. Just last year, as all of you know, students were able to engage the entire world in their own revolutionary efforts, which became known as the Arab Spring. Now, obviously, in recent weeks, we've seen how those efforts have become much more complicated, and that is a discussion for another night. But I wonder, this is a question for anyone on the panel, were the real-time Facebook images and social media feeds from social protesters involved in the Arab Spring a form of propaganda? Were they truthful information transmitted in real time? Were they citizen journalism? Were they a combination of all of these things? In other words, do we laud the Arab Spring messaging because we agreed with the goals of those students?
Well, this may be the biggest danger of a fragmented, you know, sort of media culture, which is that, you know, to go back to the Daniel Moynihan quote, one man's propaganda is another man's fact. And, you know, Hitler, I think he fulfilled the promise of that poster. So is it propaganda, or is he basically saying, I'm gonna do something very aggressive with this country that's down on its heels? You know, I'm not defending what he ended up doing, but I get into, you know, arguments about politics, you know, all the time with friends and relatives, and just had at a Rosh Hashanah dinner some very fierce, you know, partisan arguments with cousins of mine, and you know, they think everything that comes out of the Obama campaign is propaganda, and everything that comes out of the Romney campaign is true, and I think the opposite. So it's, it's. I guess to answer your question, if we like the outcome, we tend to think it's not propaganda.
If I agree, they are noble defenders of the truth. If not, they are shameless propagandists.
Yeah. If you were against the protests in the Middle East for whatever reason, whatever legitimate argument you could make against it, maybe there isn't one. Actually, I can't think of one. But if you were, you would say These are agitating students, and they've just come up with some agitprop, you know, discontent, and what do they know, and they're ruining the society. So you could see it as propaganda.
We did see how quickly they were sidelined, too. So we're really quite a ways away from the Arab Spring and the promise that
although I think you'd agree, Nancy, they were much more difficult to silence because of the advances in technology
sure.
than students armed with a mimeograph machine several decades ago might have been. Tom, you wanted to weigh in on behalf of Mubarak, if I'm not mistaken?
Not this time. Just to make that point, Dan, what you're talking about here, was the internet more important in terms of the Arab Spring as a vehicle to bring people together in social protest, or was it more important for the messages that were being conveyed? I wouldn't necessarily call Mubarak's Egypt totalitarian in the dominant sense of a real totalitarian government, but it was a control government, and Assad's Syria is even worse. But is the internet a way to kind of circumvent the absolutely dominating structure in place to keep people from meeting and organizing politically? And I think that's one of the interesting questions coming out of it. Was it the actual messages, or was it a vehicle to bring people together who were similarly inclined anyways in terms of their views of the regime?
Well, I would happily go on, just me and Daniel and the panelists, for another couple of hours. We could turn this into the Jesse Unruh Institute telethon. We would bring in Jim Lewis, and we would not go home until we had exhausted every fiber of their intellectual being. That'd be a bit selfish, though. So what we're going to do now, albeit belatedly, is we want to open up this conversation to questions. And just a couple of quick points, and for those of you who've attended some of our other Unruh Institute events, you've heard this before. We ask a couple things of you when you join the conversation. One, you tell us who you are, so we know who is joining the conversation. Second, we ask in fact that your question in fact is a question, as opposed to a comment, a statement, a speech, a polemic, a diatribe, depending on whether we agree with it. And finally, particularly if you're going to ask a question of someone with whom you disagree, we ask that you treat them with the same respect and regard that you would hope that they would treat you if they were to ask you of something they disagreed. So with that, let's open it up to questions. Sir.
Well, I'd like to try to segue off that last one, and I've got a question here. But on January 25th, 2010, I was in Luxor, Egypt, when I came into forces that were on the street and looked like a huge parade. 800 students, maybe give or take, or young people at least. And I learned later what was happening, but the next day we lost the internet, the day after that we lost cell phone service, and the day after that we lost television access. But that, I understand, was being done by Mubarak's government. So how does this work in terms of control in media? Because that did help them, I think, to gather, but something else was going on there. Even being there, I didn't really understand it.
Well, so I guess the question, as I understand, Tom, is the technology is a means to an end, and the technology is neither the end to itself, nor is it the substantive differentiator. And even when the technology went away, the message itself found ways to continue to disseminate. At what point is the technology less important than the substance of the message itself?
Well, one of the things that you raised by your question is, particularly in the countries we're talking about, the internet is, there's a race going on. There's a race between the dissenters and the government. And it's the technology is the vehicle that's being used in this race. I mean, it's who can catch up to whom first and who can stay ahead of the other side. And I think, you know, it's interesting, when the internet started 30 years ago, I think there were a lot of lofty predictions, particularly from people who believe in a kind of freedom of expression, that the world's changed in our favor. And I think to a certain extent that happens initially. But then governments get kind of wise and, you know, in a perverse sense, and they begin to catch up. And I think that was kind of playing itself out, certainly in the Egyptian Revolution, and we see it in other places too. So the scenario you presented is very consistent with what's going on, and I think there's something of a consensus right now from some writers that actually the internet is more of a tool for oppressive governments to find out who you are, to find out where we can get you, to jam messages, and it's very much an open question who's ahead in this race.
And if you watch the way Google and Yahoo negotiate with the government of China, if you watch the controversy over whether YouTube should or should not have pulled some of the videos that led to the violence last week, and for those of you who did not see it, the International Herald Tribune reported today that the country of Iran is actually in the process of developing its own internet, its own online communication network, independent from the rest of the world, in order to protect its citizens.
Can I add just one quick thing?
Nancy, can I ask this? Just because we've got a lot of questions.
Okay, sure.
We want to make sure you guys all have a chance to weigh in, but we want to get to as many of the questions as possible. Sir, in the back.
Thank you very much. Yeah, my name is Peter Daniels, and I happen to be a Holocaust survivor also. Two things. Number one, my limited knowledge of American history tells me that we've had pretty nasty campaigns going all the way back to the 1800s. So I don't think this is anything new. We weren't around then. But I think if you read history, you'll find out a lot of political campaigns left a lot to be desired. Second of all, once I think we have a constitutional right of free speech, that genie is out of the bottle. And the more we want to make sure that we protect our freedom to speak, the more we are going to see this. I'm not sure how we're ever going to solve this. The only way is a dictatorship and censorship. Thank you.
Thank you. Nancy, two great points here. Of course, negative campaigning is nothing new at all. But these tools of technology allow that message to be disseminated much more quickly to a much more targeted audience. And then second, I think the gentleman makes an absolutely critically important point, is the way to combat hate speech is not to ban it. But to overcome it. Your thoughts?
Well, you all know Edward Bernays, right, who was sort of considered the father of American public relations, and he penned a book called Propaganda, and Bernays talked about different types of propaganda. Jacques Ellul, in his book Propaganda, refers to it in a plural sense. But Bernays said there is propaganda and impropaganda. So indeed, the answer to the hate speech that goes on is not the censoring. We know that. You have to combat it with your own argument. The point I wanted to make earlier is if the 64 Daisy ad were about national security problem with the nuclear threat, in 1996, Bob Dole did his own Daisy Girl ad, but this time it was about the war on drugs. Today, I would argue, after 20 years of teaching in a classroom, the biggest national security problem I see is a lack of critical thinking and comprehensive thinking. It worries me all the time. We are creating, really, people who are sort of going along with the program, even our educational process. I'm here on one of the most outstanding campuses in the world. But we need to teach courses around this subject. We need to give people who are committed to human rights and human dignity and free speech the tools with which to go out and combat the worst forms of propaganda. I can't emphasize that enough. And I want to applaud everybody who's here tonight for coming, because this is it's a national security problem. It really is. So.
Yes, all the way over here on the far left or far right, depending on which way you're facing.
I'm Nathan Selvidge. I'm a student here at the university. And my question is kind of relating to the Hitler poster that we showed. You guys were commenting on how its simplicity was kind of its strongest point, and to me, it really reminded me of the Obama campaign's Hope poster from 4 years ago. And you were kind of commenting on how this election, a lot of the ads are very wordy and lengthy and are really lacking that simplicity. And I'm just kind of wondering what changed from 4 years ago to now, where 4 years ago we had like hope and change, and that was the message that, to a student like me at least, it seems like won the election. And what happened to that?
Eli, it seems to me that a challenger's campaign or a non-incumbents campaign, by definition, is always simpler because it is more aspirational. And after 4 years of the realities of governing, both good and bad, it becomes necessarily more complicated.
But the message is a more complicated one now than it was 4 years ago, and that's a real challenge for the Obama campaign.
Yeah, I mean, there's an old quote, and I can't remember. Ooh, I keep losing my microphone here. There's an old quote that goes, you campaign in poetry and you govern in prose. I think Obama, 4 years ago, you know, because his election was so historic, because he stood for so many things in this country and around the world, and may have been able to also be a lot of things to a lot of different people, which I think they took advantage of very well, he was a symbol, he was an icon. And I think now that he has to govern, he has a record that's complicated in that, you know, he hasn't been able to do everything everyone's wanted, and some people disagreed with things he's done, even among his supporters. And weirdly, I think the simplicity and iconography of the Obama poster and message and what he stood for 4 years ago is why Romney, as a challenger, isn't really able to have a simple, distilled message. Romney is still blocked by the Obama of 4 years ago, because even though there are a lot of people who are dissatisfied with Obama's performance as president, he's still considered a historic figure. He's still so much better liked than most presidents have been with these economic numbers and respected. And so Romney has been trying to awkwardly thread a needle of, well, we need to kick him out, but he's a decent guy, but maybe I don't think he's a decent guy this week, and it's been very tortured. So I think neither of them are really able to take advantage of the traditional raw symbolism, and I think that's a great point, that poster is exactly the sort of converse of the Hitler poster. The optimistic version.
It's an excellent insight on your part, and Eli, I think it's a terrific analysis. And for those of you who watched the campaign over the course of the last several months, and I'm guessing that's most of you, you noticed that for many months Romney articulated a message about Obama very similar to the one that Eli was just talking about, recognizing that voters had formed this very strong emotional connection with him in 2008. Romney and his advisors decided, well, we like him, we respect him, he's just not doing so well. He's a really good person, but he doesn't quite get it. And after several months of this, public opinion polls showed that the personal favorability ratings for Barack Obama were way, way above his job approval ratings. And what that was doing, the Romney campaign realized to their consternation, was re-electing him. Because voters were saying, all right, he hasn't fixed everything yet, but we like him, we respect him, we trust him. And so that's probably
Although I would say that the Romney campaign, I don't know that they're primarily responsible for that. I think that some of it is just that Obama comes across as hugely likable and not emotionally needy in the way that a lot of politicians are of the voters, and somebody who people respect. And I actually think, just looking at it purely tactically, that Romney's in a very difficult box, because if he did experiment with changing that formulation and with saying he's dividing the country and he's led the most corrupt administration and all this stuff, and no one buys it. It just doesn't sync up with this guy who people may not like what he's done as president, but seems like a decent guy. So I think actually the Romney campaign is a little bit trapped by this.
Look, okay, Obama makes his own beer.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
Tom and Nancy are
understandably chomping at the bit here, because there's a fascinating conversation to be had on how this campaign has played out at all sorts of levels, particularly as it relates to the president's connection with the voters. But I'll just say quickly to Eli, as I agree with your point, but I think when your most virulent and strongest opponent spends time telling people what a good, decent man you are, that does undermine the...
I'm sure you're right. I just don't know that he had a good alternative, actually, because I think when he switched, he had to switch back.
But this is a much longer conversation that goes in a different direction, and I'll take advantage of this to ask Eli and to ask Tom and to ask Nancy and Steve also, if you'd like, to come back for some of our panels that we hold over the course of the election campaign. I think we have time for one more question, and I've been focusing in this direction, so I'm wondering if there's anyone over here who would like to weigh in. If not, yes, sir.
Yeah, my name is Joel Marine, and I'm proud to say that I'm Dana Sherman's father-in-law. Fascinating discussion, and I'm just curious about the implications of the trends you talk about for the two-party system, if you have any thoughts on that, like emergence of third parties, that sort of thing. Any thoughts?
If any of the panelists would like to weigh in on the question of a third party, in other words, and I think to put the question in the context of our broader conversation, it's a fascinating one. You know, when you are propagandizing, when you are attempting to motivate or inspire voters or to instill fear in them, is it necessarily a zero-sum game? In other words, if I'm frightening people about Daniel, which I know looks somewhat improbable, but he's a fairly fearful person, in a one-on-one campaign, when there's two parties, if I frighten them about him, their only recourse is to come to me. And a three-party, a four-party, a multiple-party, multiple-candidate campaign, things get awful, get awfully complicated.
Very quickly, I'll give you a very quick reason why I think there will never in any of our lifetimes be a serious third party that will do more than take a few points from one side and throw the election to one side, which is that now, because of social media, because of the internet, and because of something we alluded to earlier, which is micro-targeting, where you can get deep inside little niche pockets of certain swing voters within a single, area of a single state, anytime any serious movement begins, like the Tea Party, that could, potentially have spilled into some kind of a third party, one of the parties will see it and co-opt it. It just happens over and over again. Ross Perot, 20 years ago, came out and was talking about deficit reduction. It was weeks before both the major parties were, had charts, and here's what was happening with the deficit. And I think now it would happen in days. It's just they're too smart. They're big, sophisticated businesses with hundreds of millions of dollars dedicated to this stuff. So even though, Dan is 100% right about that basic principle, I think that they won't be allowed to happen.
Tom, Nancy?
Well, remember New Coke.
You had a point you were going to make, Tom?
Well, I have a political consultant, by the way.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Eli brought up the Tea Party. I mean, the Tea Party, by all measures, should have been a third party. And instead, what the Tea Party movement became was a cranky part of the Republican Party. And the Republican Party sort of has never quite known what to do with it. They think that the Tea Party is good for them at one level, but the other level, the whole fiasco around raising the debt ceiling was totally Tea Party driven. So it's very interesting the way that seems to have been, the Tea Party, if it's who we think they are, which is mainly an older part of the electorate, they're not going to use social media anyways because that's way past their generation. But nevertheless, the way they're going about it is a very interesting kind of modern contemporary way of getting their voices heard.
Well, I think what Tom's just pointed to correctly is the difference between a specific issue-driven movement and a broader political party. The PT Party, for better or worse, has become part of the Republican Party. The occupiers, for better or worse, were, for the large part, pretty much ignored by the Democratic Party. I think I go back to Eli's point. Ross Perot, it's been 20 years since Ross Perot's campaign for president, and it is worth remembering that at one point in the campaign, before he went insane in public, he was actually running first in public opinion polls ahead of both Bill Clinton and George W. Bush, but Eli's point is exactly the right one. The two major political parties at this point in our history are not particularly good at very many things at all. The one extraordinary talent that they do have is recognizing popular ideas and rushing to co-opt them. And the advances in technology, to his point, make it even more likely that a genuine ideological issue-based movement will invariably become part and parcel of one party or both before gathering the legs to set itself up as an ongoing third alternative.
I do think, though, that you make a great point, and that is to think beyond the dualistic modes of thinking that go on with black versus white. I mean, we need to recognize not just that there are 50 shades of political gray out there, too.
Much longer conversation for another day, but let's agree that that's why they have primaries.
That's right.
So we have covered, in 1 hour and 8 minutes, roughly 86 years of American, German, and world history, politics, and communications. Perhaps not to the depth and level of detail that we would have liked, but given the time constraints and given the amount of material to cover, I think you'd agree that our panelists have done a phenomenal job of leading us through a fascinating conversation. Let's thank Dr. Stephen Luckert, let's thank Eli Addy, let's thank Nancy Snow, and let's thank Tom Waldman for a terrific conversation. You guys were terrific. We really, really do appreciate it. Let's thank Daniel Rothberg for being a phenomenal Let's once again thank our friends at the Shoah Foundation, both Stephen Smith and Dan Lesham, for all the work they've done in our helping with the program. A special thanks, of course, to the entire team from the U.S. Holocaust Museum. And once again, if you don't have the opportunity to get to Washington, then it's worth going online and seeing this exhibit, because it is worth the time and the thoughts it will engender in you. Michael, Dana, Chris, thank you so much for coming here and helping us have this conversation. I can't tell you how much we appreciate it. And Dana, your father-in-law will tell us embarrassing family stories. I also want to thank, as always, the tremendous team at the Unruh Institute of Politics for making these events work so effectively, particularly tonight, Chui Nguyen and Laura Hill, Kirsten Olson, and Adrena Hidalgo, and our entire team of student workers for making this program come off as so well. And as I mentioned earlier, when we realized that we had the opportunity to bring an event like this to campus, it took me literally nanoseconds to realize that the first and most important place for me to reach out to were my friends at the Casden Institute. So let's take a moment especially to thank Lisa Ansel and Bruce Zuckerman for all their help and their support. In just a moment, we hope you'll join us at a reception just under that exit sign. That's not a diabolical way to get you out of the there actually is a reception on the other side of that door. We hope you'll join us, and we think that some of our panelists will be able to stick around for questions that we did not have the time to ask. But before we go, I'd like to ask Bruce Zuckerman to come up to take the microphone to help us conclude with a few words. Bruce, thank you so much.
Thank you. As the band said, I'm Bruce Zuckerman, the Myron, Marian, and Casden Director of the USC Casden Institute for the Study of the Jewish Role in American Life, and I'm also a professor here in the School of Religion. So on behalf of the Casden Institute, this has sort of been a round robin of thank yous, but don't you think it's a panel like this deserves it? I want to make sure that we, as partners, acknowledge the USC Shoah Foundation, the Institute for Visual Education and Visual History and Education, the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, and the Unruh Institute for Politics for being such good partners with us. So Stephen Smith started this evening with observations about what he did this afternoon. And I thought I would tell you what I did this afternoon because it is vaguely relevant. Now you have to understand that when I'm not doing stuff like this, I study the ancient world. And so what was I doing this afternoon? I was with a bunch of colleagues and we were staring at really wonderful images of ancient coinage, all kinds of ancient coins, but they were in bad shape. They were all crudded up, they were all corroded and everything. And we were trying to see what was really there. And we were using a fabulous imaging system called reflectance transformation imaging. And what this does is allows you to take originally 32 pictures from different light angles, and then you use a really wonderful program that allows you to make a master image, and you can move the light around wherever you want and see it from one angle or another, or I can put two lights on it, or I can change the reflectivity, and it's wonderful. And we were making great progress, and we could see things that we hadn't seen before, and I was worried. I worry about what it's called. Listen to the words, reflectance transformation imaging. They don't sound like reliable words. It reflects what's been transformed into somebody's image. But one thing that's very interesting about it is it's different than what photographers normally do. Photographers force the viewer to see it the way they have set it up. But in these images, it's the user who gets to decide what perspective is to be used. And so that's really exciting because you can do this. So what does that have anything to do with what we're talking about today? Well, when I'm trying to decide what's the best way of looking at an image, I don't sit the light in one place. I move it around. And in fact, it's in the movement that you see most reliably what's really going on. It's not Is it better over here? Is it better over there? It's how you move. So my humble suggestion to all of you tonight, having listened to this panel, is keep your perspective on the move. Be dynamic, because it's only when you move and you look from different ways at different things that you can look through all the crud and sometimes see what's really there. So anyway, thank you all tonight for coming and joining me.